This is the Site C Dam, a hydroelectric megaproject in a country that's known as a big player in the hydropower sector. This is not just any project, but the most expensive one ever built in the whole of Canada. And it's also a highly debated one. Site C will provide renewable energy for 450,000 homes. But since construction started back in 2015, the budget has almost doubled to around $12 billion. The project has many critics, from political figures and journalists to indigenous groups and environmental activists. On the other hand, its clean energy might be crucial for Canada's sustainable goals and economic growth. Despite the controversy, the developer is determined to finish the project. Why? Well, in today's video, we're gonna find out as we take a deep dive into the most expensive dam Canada has ever built. Site C is a hydroelectric power station. You can kind of think of it as a battery. The stored water behind the dam holds potential energy. If the water is released, the potential energy converts into kinetic energy. The water roars through the turbines, which start to turn, and generators can then produce electricity from it. Easy, right? Well, not really. In any case, Canada produces 60% of its electricity from hydropower, making it the third largest hydropower producer in the world. In fact, Site C is actually one of 475 hydroelectric power stations in Canada. Why so many? Well, hydropower just makes sense for Canada. There's plenty of water, the technology is reliable and efficient, and the energy produced is renewable, relatively clean, and relatively cheap. All that to say, Site C is nothing out of the ordinary in terms of infrastructure, but it's still pretty impressive. When the dam is finished, it should look something like this. At 1,000 meters across, 500 meters wide, and 60 meters tall, the dam contains 16 million cubic meters of earth-fill material.
Earth-fill dams, because of their wide base, are best suited to site conditions that have wide valleys, steep slopes, and relatively weaker non-homogeneous type soils. And these are the conditions we typically find here in the Peace region in northern BC.
Most of it came from on-site excavations, but some had to be brought in and was transported on a 5 kilometer long conveyor belt system. That might seem like a lot even for a dam, but it's built to withstand a once in every 10,000 years earthquake that many say British Columbia is overdue for. The reservoir behind the dam will be filled over 4 months once the remaining infrastructure has been completed. 83 kilometers of the Peace River will be flooded in the process, creating a reservoir more than half the size of Washington, D.C. And once it's operational, the site will produce 5,100 gigawatt hours of electricity per year, increasing British Columbia's entire supply by about 8%. Not only that, but the electricity will be renewable, available on demand, and relatively affordable, at least according to the builders. So, what's the catch? If Site C can produce so much renewable energy, why has it come under criticism? To find out, let's turn back the clock for a second and try and understand the bigger picture. This is the Peace River in 1872, long before anyone was thinking about using it for hydropower. And this is the Peace River today. You see, Site C isn't the only dam on the river. There are actually three, and they're all part of one huge hydropower project that was first proposed back in the 1950s. The first dam, the W.A.C. Bennett, was built in 1967 and created the Williston Reservoir. The dam was, at the time, the largest earth-filled structure ever built, and to this day, Williston remains the seventh biggest reservoir by volume in the entire world. Several years later, in 1980, a second dam was built further downstream at Peace Canyon. As you can see here, the dinosaur reservoir it created is much smaller than the Williston Reservoir, but that's one of the major upsides of this project. By building multiple dams on one river, the same water can be reused to produce electricity as it moves downstream. And that brings us to Site C. Despite years of pressure from BC Hydro, the publicly owned company behind all three dams, the provincial government repeatedly rejected Site C. BC Hydro was predicting a 2% rise year over year in the demand for electricity, but the provincial government just flat out saw things differently. Until finally, in 2014, the project was approved. What changed? The people. British Columbia's population had tripled in the time since Site C was first proposed. The economy had skyrocketed, and Canada had begun its move towards net zero. With all that in mind, the provincial government finally agreed that there was sufficient demand for more electricity. And in July 2015, with the budget set at around $6.4 billion, construction finally began. But as per usual with these mega projects, not everyone was in agreement. Before signing off on Site C, the government had ordered a thorough review of the project. The man in charge of the process was called Harry Swain, and he spoke out publicly on the proposal. He disagreed completely with BC Hydro's justification for Site C.
My name is Harry Swain, and I chaired the joint review panel on Site C. Since 2005, domestic demand for electricity in BC has been essentially flat. Hydro, of course, had predicated the need for the dam on demand that was growing at about 2% a year indefinitely. It's not happening.
Ultimately, he believed that there simply wasn't the need for another dam. He said that if the demand for electricity did increase, British Columbia could produce more through alternative sources. And he wasn't the only one who thought this either. Opposition leader John Horgan was openly opposed to the dam. That's him right there. He promised a comprehensive review into the project if he was to be elected in 2017. Fast forward a little, and Horgan was indeed elected. By that time, construction had already been underway for 2 years, and it was already running late and over budget. But Horgan kept his word and ordered the review. The conclusion was that if Site C ran any further over budget, it would no longer be economically viable. Rather, it would become more expensive than the cost of scrapping the whole project altogether. In the official document, the reviewers tried to remain as neutral as possible and clearly pointed out that this was all dependent on future energy needs that were impossible to calculate with certainty. But in other notes, publicly accessible through the Utilities Commission website, members of the review board were more outspoken. And so, in the face of the situation, and keeping in mind Horgan's previous opinion about the dam, the newly elected Horgan decided to continue with construction? He said that it wasn't the project that he would have favored, but that it must be completed. Canceling a megaproject of this size during construction definitely is a tough decision. Nevertheless, they faced still more challenges. In a 2020 progress report issued by BC Hydro themselves, they classified the overall health of the project as red. They mention serious concerns over schedule, scope, and budget, and discuss structural issues with some of the foundations. And speaking of foundations, there's a prehistory, well before construction even began. You see, Site C doesn't sit on solid bedrock, but rather on shale or soft rock that can move under shifting pressure. This isn't a deal breaker, as 16 other dams around the world have been built on similar ground, but it's still crucial to have a stable foundation, especially in an area where landslides are not uncommon. So to fix this, BC Hydro came up with a pretty unique concept. Instead of having a dam running straight across the river, they chose this L-shaped design that you can see here. On top of that, they incorporated a concrete buttress below the dam to increase stability and protect against seismic activity. They laid down roller-compacted concrete on the shorter leg of the L, and then built some key components, like the spillway and the generating station on top. Doing this provided a firmer base than the unstable shale, which makes up the south bank of the river, and improved the overall stability of the dam. As things stand today, construction is almost completed. And after talking to Hydro BC directly, they mentioned that they plan to start filling the Site C reservoir on August 25th. The most recent estimates put the real cost here at around $12 billion, making it the most expensive dam that Canada has ever built. Part of this cost increase was attributed to geotechnical delays and construction slowdowns caused by COVID. But the real cost isn't only measured in dollars and cents. The controversy around the dam is about more than just money or even safety. You see, Site C sits on Treaty 8 land. Treaty 8 is an agreement dating back all the way to 1899. It covers an area bigger than France and protects the rights of 39 indigenous First Nations communities to hunt, fish, and trap on their ancestral land. Flooding the Peace River to create the Site C reservoir will destroy almost 10,000 hectares of this land, infringing the constitutional rights of the Treaty 8 First Nations. Even John Horgan, before his 180 on the project, spoke out on behalf of Treaty 8, and he wasn't alone either.
First Nations in the region have entrenched constitutional rights, not just the requirement for consultation and accommodation, which we always hear about when we're talking about resource projects, but they have entrenched constitutional rights to practice hunting and fishing as before. And that's going to be violated by this dam. And I think the Treaty 8 bans, and Liz Logan, Chief Liz Logan, very articulate, is going to push the government on this very heavily.
In 2019, the United Nations called for construction to be suspended until an agreement was reached with the affected First Nations. Construction didn't stop, but eventually an agreement was reached. And of course, a mega project like this affects more than just people. The Peace River Valley is also home to a wide range of wildlife that'll be displaced or killed by the reservoir. One report states that there are at least 63 species threatened by the construction. In fact, the WWF openly condemned Site C, saying it will cause irreparable harm to local wildlife. Beavers, birds, bears, and elk will all lose access to their natural habitat and migratory routes. BC Hydro plan to replace the wetlands that the project will destroy, but rebuilding ecosystems takes a long time, and critics say the damage will already be done. So, looking at the big picture here, it's fair to say that Site C, just like many mega projects we cover, faces a lot of challenges, economically, environmentally, and socially. So, you might be wondering right around now why BC Hydro and the government are so determined to push ahead with it. Well, there are three answers to that question. The first is the most obvious: electricity. Site C will produce clean, renewable electricity for over 100 years, and lots of it. When it's operational, the output will be enough to power 1.7 million electric vehicles every single year. And hydroelectric power is actually one of the cleanest forms of electricity that there is. BC Hydro actually says that Site C will produce fewer greenhouse gases per gigawatt hour than most of the alternatives, including wind and solar. But it's not just the amount of electricity that's important here, it's also the availability. Inside the dam, there's something called a head gate. It opens and closes to control the amount of water that flows through the dam at any given time. By using the head gate, the dam can produce more electricity when demand is high and reduce production when demand is low. This is a pretty crucial difference between hydropower and other renewables like wind and solar. We can't control how much wind or sun there is, but we can control how much water flows through a dam. That makes hydroelectric projects like Site C super efficient. And because Site C is the third in a series of dams on the same river, it's even more efficient. In fact, by reusing water from upstream, Site C will actually produce 35% of the electricity that's generated at the bigger WAC Bennett Dam, but with only 5% of the reservoir area. As a result, Site C provides a large amount of clean electricity using a relatively small amount of land. Yes, thousands of hectares will be lost to flooding, but way less than if the dam was built on a river without the existing infrastructure. And at the end of the day, the electricity has to come from somewhere, right? The second reason for pushing ahead with this project is economics. Despite being so expensive, Site C brings a wide range of economic benefits to the region and to British Columbia more broadly. According to BC Hydro, the construction of Site C will add $130 million to regional GDP and $3.2 billion to the GDP of British Columbia as a whole. In other words, Site C will generate a lot of work, both directly through construction and indirectly through the purchase of goods and services. In February of this year, over 2,700 people were working on site. In fact, if we add up all the hours of work that'll go into the construction itself, it works out to 10,000 employment years. And if we include all the manufacturers and service providers whose work goes into Site C from elsewhere, that number goes up to 33,000 years. All this work and activity helps to grow the economy as a whole and has positive effects on development across the province. And we should also point out that BC Hydro has invested in many projects to help repair some of the damage done to communities and wildlife as a result of Site C. Projects like the $13 million Indigenous Traditional Use Fund to preserve land and resources for traditional use, or employing a full-time conservation officer to look after local wildlife. And on top of all of that, there's also the fact that the government has already spent billions of dollars on the project. If the government bowed to pressure and stopped construction now, most of that money would be lost, which doesn't look too good on the balance sheet. Okay, so that brings us to the third reason. This one is a little bit more speculative, and it's definitely up for debate. But basically, Site C isn't the only project that British Columbia has been working on. This is the Coastal GasLink pipeline. It's a 670-kilometer pipe that will take natural gas from northeast British Columbia to the west coast. And where does the pipe start? Here in Dawson Creek, 63 kilometers away from Site C. Why? Well, gas extracted from the earth has to be processed in Dawson Creek before it can be sent through the pipeline. On the other end, here in Kitimat, it's then cooled to a liquid, giving us liquid natural gas, or LNG for short. And these processes require a huge amount of, you guessed it, electricity. The LNG produced at the end is sold abroad for huge profits. So some think that Site C is actually being built as a means of producing the electricity needed to prepare LNG for export. The British Columbian government stands to make $23 billion in revenue from this export project alone, as well as another $24 billion in private sector investment. But with enormous gas reserves all across Canada, the potential profits could be huge. And the market's there. Asian countries are lining up to buy Canadian gas, which the government still says is environmentally friendly because it will transition Asia away from coal. BC Hydro have addressed this controversy, saying that Site C would be required with or without an LNG sector. They point out that British Columbia's electric grid is integrated, meaning that all the electricity is pooled together no matter where it's going or where it's from. But critics say that using hydropower to process natural gas is simply an attempt to greenwash a climate-unfriendly industry, prioritizing profit over the public good. What's your opinion on that? Is it still better to provide the energy needed for LNG through hydropower? Do you agree with the greenwashing argument? In any case, Site C is due to start producing electricity sometime next year. And since they start filling the reservoir at the end of August, this deadline actually seems pretty realistic. If things go according to plan, we'll finally be able to see what the Peace River Valley will look like. And in the coming years, we can examine again whether Site C was worth it or not. Perhaps the increase in clean electricity will make up for the project being so over budget. Or perhaps the legacy of environmental degradation, the LNG industry, and Indigenous land rights will hang over the dam for its whole life. One thing's for sure though, people will be talking about it. If you enjoyed this video, make sure to subscribe to Mega Builds for more. Thanks a lot for watching, and as always, we'll see you in the next video.